here today, guys, about all of the awesome things that are happening about getting us back to space and into these space. And Mr. Willis, Mars. So Mr. Willis is here. He is from, oh, come on in, guys. There's plenty of space over here. He is from Marshall Space Center. He's going to talk to us about all. All of the cool things that are happening and share with you a little bit about some of the things you brought with us to look at today. So Mr. Willis, meet Seth Frame.
Well, hello and good morning, everybody. First of all, thank you all for having me. It's an honor. I would rather do this every day of the week, every hour of the week, than the other things I do. And I work for NASA. Yep, I happen to be working at the place that's building the space launch system. I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a second. But spending time with you all is the most important thing to me, because anything that we build, it's you all that are going to be doing the exploration on this. You will hear me say this again. 2030, we're actually launching our mission to Mars. 2020, we're actually going back to the moon. If you look at 2030, that's only 11 years away. All right, I'm an old guy. I'm not going to be the person piloting that. I'm just trying to hang out for that launch, hit it back to Mars. But it's going to be the knowledge that's held within each one of you all that's going to give us that capability. As you all, if you want to join NASA and think about employment in aerospace, whether it's for the government or working for a private sector, that's going to give us everything that we need to go to Mars and beyond, because that's the mission. Heading out to your rover and further. That being said, I'm gonna stop right there. I actually have something for you all to take a look at real quick, and then I'll come back, because you're gonna like this better than hearing my voice.
Kennedy said, quote, the other thing, go to the moon and the other thing. And we are finally at a point through the evolution of the Orion spacecraft and SLS that we're taking the next giant leap for all mankind that Neil was talking about. The one thing I've always thought of Mars is when they describe it as the planet that's most similar to Earth, which of course makes you think, well, it sounds like that's the first one we should visit.
It's essential that we go and find out what is out there.
The incredible pride that all the people making
parts wore out. It's important to get around to all of these vendors to see the pieces and the people that make those pieces.
As the mayor of the city of Cerritos, I see firsthand what these programs will do for a city.
A lot of these places that build things, they're like the cornerstone of their community. They're one of the big businesses in their community, and they're keeping those small communities thriving.
Think about taking humans off of our planet and putting them on another planet, Mars, for the first time. It's just incredibly exciting to me.
It's happening now. We have begun the journey to Mars.
So, truly, we have begun that journey to Mars. This is the system that's going to take us there, the space launch system. You heard about it. Once again, the name's Gary Willis from the NASA Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama. How many of you all ever heard about Marshall Space Flight Center before? Okay. How many of you all have heard about Johnson? What about Kennedy? Everybody knows Kennedy because that's where the launches happen. Well, so Marshall is the home of propulsion. And something very important just happened at Marshall. With NASA having its 10 centers, something happened for the first time in history at Marshall. Marshall, in its over 40-year history, over 50-year history at Marshall, for the very first time, just 2 weeks ago, a woman has taken the helm to be the director of Marshall Space Flight Center. Jody Singer, she was actually, Jody Singer used to work on the shuttle missions. She actually has some of the history of the Saturn V, the Apollo mission. That, I said that for a specific reason. Each one of you all here, you heard me talk about mindset, us moving towards the future. You all are only limited by what you believe that you can do. Whoops, I forgot to turn my mic on, I just got the book. You all are only limited by what you believe you can do. Jody Singer believed that she had the capabilities to be in aerospace, to be an engineer, working on propulsion systems for the space launch system, for the shuttle. She also worked on the propulsion system for this. And today she sits as the director of Marshall Space Flight Center and is actually testifying right now on the Hill. Matter of fact, she'll be in about a couple of hours on the Hill before Congress concerning the next 60 years of space exploration. So I wanted to leave you, talk about that real quick because there's opportunities for each one of you all, and don't forget that. Mention that we're one of 10 centers. I like to say this, if you heard about Johnson, that's where the astronauts are. If you heard about Kennedy, that's where they're launching. Well, anything that Kennedy wants to launch that is pretty much NASA, has a NASA partnership, or as we work with contractors, or anything that Johnson wants to fly, that comes out of Marshall. We're the propulsion home for NASA. That being said, I'll put it to you this way. We can go everywhere without Johnson and Kennedy, but they can't go anywhere with us. So we supply not only the car, we bring the keys, we bring the motor, we bring everything. That being said, Marshall has over 6,000 employees. We help to employ over 48,000 people across the country. That's just, and we're actually the second largest employer in Huntsville. That's just a little bit of background. Huntsville, Alabama, second largest research park. Why is that important? Technology comes from research. Research comes from the mind of individuals who just have a great question, who look at something completely different, or look at something slightly different than it's ever been used before. That's a gift that each one of you all have been given. Hold on to that. Even if it's looking at a math problem, or how you even just decide to design a piece of clothing, or just how you get from one place to another. Continue to look at things differently. What Marshall really focuses on is several key missions, primarily propulsion systems for deep space exploration. I'll explain why this space launch system is so important. Payload operations. Many of y'all have heard of the International Space Station, right? All right, how many miles is the International Space Station above your head? I heard somebody say, what, 15? 13, OK. okay, I heard, I'm hearing two, little higher. If it was 2 miles, man, that thing would be kind of low. 250 miles above your head, falling around the earth at over 18,000 miles an hour. So 250 miles is not far away. So one of the things that Marshall actually does, Johnson actually controls the mission of the International Space Station. Marshall actually has all the payload operations, all the science activities that go on Marshall, all those things, we control the payload operations. So that's also one of the missions that we have. We also have home of a lot of IT technology, and then dealing with satellite imagery, being able to take really deep looks in space with the Chandra system, taking a look at environmental activities, Hubble Space System. Many of you all have talked or heard about the James Webb, new James Webb telescope. I actually had the chance to see that over the summer. Man, that thing is incredible. That being said, let me move on. You heard me talk about this Space Launch System. This rocket, over 324 feet tall, it is the tallest rocket that will ever be built. It's actually under its construction right now. It has over 8.8 million pounds of thrust, all right? So, what does that really mean? Well, that's a lot of thrust. So I like to put it in simple terms, because I'm not a scientist or an engineer. 8.8 million pounds of thrust. Okay, everybody knows what a Chevy Corvette is? How many Chevy Corvette engines do you think 8.8 million pounds of thrust equals to as far as horsepower? I heard 20,000, I heard 5 million, what? A billion, man, that's a lot of horsepower. It is actually, it will be equivalent to 160,000 Corvette engines. And I'm not talking about those old Corvettes, I'm talking about the new ones, all right? So that is how much thrust. And when you think about that much thrust, wow, that's like 24,600, 26,200, depending upon its engine setup, as far as miles an hour, or 32.4 Mach. You go, wow, that's really fast. So with all that that I just gave you, you know, 24 to 26,000 miles an hour, you know, 8.8 million pounds of thrust, how fast do you think that that rocket can go from being ground zero into Earth orbit? How fast? How many minutes or hours? You write this. You say 2 minutes. All right, I got you before, I'm gonna get somebody else. All right, you right there. 6 minutes, okay? Let's see, young lady, you right there. 8 minutes? Spot on. Were you in here before? Wow, in under 8 minutes time, that rocket will actually leave ground zero and get into Earth's orbit. That is really important because a lot of people go, if it's going that fast, how can a human sustain that? Well, because it's like getting out of a chair, if you think about it. It's not taking off like this. If you've ever seen a rocket launch, it is a slow lift. So as the thrust builds and the rocket gains its speed, what actually happens is then the G-forces start getting applied. As the G-forces get applied, the human body can easily sustain it because it's not, you know, hypothetically, you know, all these G's loaded on you at once. It's a gradual build, just like if you think of getting out of a chair. That being said, what you see here is the overall rocket build on its mobile launch pad, which will actually going to be put together on and move right out to the launch site. You see the RS-25 engine that is one of four engines with the two solid rocket boosters, which will give you that 8.8 million pounds of thrust and actually boost the testing. I mentioned to you that this rocket is actually, quite honestly, being built by suppliers, by businesses, small and large, over 3,200 vendors across all 50 states. It's taking America to actually build this rocket, which is really important because this we can't do it by ourselves as being NASA. And that's, once again, your future brain power is what's going to help to get us there. What you actually see right there is what's called a core tank. I like to term it as, this is my speak, not necessarily engineer speak, and because I'm not an engineer or a scientist. Think of a core tank, a gas tank, which is actually holding fuel cell, fuel and things like that, which will sit in this rocket within this component right in here, okay? And that's helping with this actual propulsion system. That's actually being built down in Michoud. Michoud is in New Orleans. And that is one of the largest assembly facilities in the world that's actually helping to build and put this rocket together. A little bit, just to close on this one slide, and then I've got another video for you. You heard me talk about the International Space Station 250 miles above your head. Okay, that is what's called LEO, Lower Earth Orbit. You heard me talk about, you know, different industry partners that are helping us as far as build the rocket. Well, those industry partners, commercial partners, actually helped us to do the supply runs to the International Space Station. So that's how we get equipment. That's how we get supplies up to the International Space Station, by getting their assistance, because NASA can't do it all by ourselves. Quite honestly, we don't want to. So that's low Earth orbit to move. Hey, that's further out. You heard me mention 2020 is going to be the launch of this space launch system. When this launches, it's going to go 70,000 miles past the moon unmanned. It's going to do that because no rocketry system has ever gone that deep into space. We're going to have the capsule, which is called the Orion, which sits right on the top of it that you saw splash down. That capsule will literally hang out for just about anywhere between 13 and 14 days, 13 to 15 days on the dark side of the moon, collecting samples as far as radiation samples, making sure all of its life support systems work, and checking those things out. Then we'll bring it back. Roughly 18 months after that, we're going to launch a manned mission, and then we're going to be looking at actually launching missions to land back on the moon to talk about gate building habitats and gateways, because in 2030, we're actually 11 years from now, a little over 11 years from now, we're starting our launch mission towards Mars. Once again, 11 years from now, hey, some of you all may be 12, you know, that'll put you at 23, whatever your age, what, you just do the math. That's why we need you all so importantly, because you all are going to be the ones getting us there. And I'm actually going to close with this video. We've had several big visits recently. One was from the Vice President and some other people. And so I'm going to tell my age, and the old folks in here will know what I'm talking about. There was this famous group that came to see us called Styx. They're a rock group. They're huge into space. They heard about what we're doing. They paid a visit to the center. They had a new album that came out, and they gave us permission to use their music. And this is actually the video that contains that.
We will return American astronauts to the moon, not only to leave behind footprints and flags, but to build the foundation we need to send Americans to Mars and beyond.
Once again, I forgot, sorry. Miss Valerie just told me I'm in a dangerous position because I'm standing between you all and lunch. So, I have time for one question. So who's got the one question that they want to ask? And I want somebody that I haven't called on before or hasn't answered a question. You can't point at your friend and poke them out. Young lady, you're in the front. Or pink, I'm sorry. Rainbow shirt. So, the question was, how long will it take to get to Mars? At current propulsion systems, a trip to Mars is 2 to 3 years. And the reason is because you have to worry about trajectory, launch trajectory, planets aligning. So, and that's round trip, all right? So you figure this, it takes about 12 months to get there, you spend 6 months on the planet, and in about 12 months to get back. You spend 6 months on the planet because you're trying to wait for the planets to line up. Now, your question is really important because, once again, here's where your brain power is going to be very critical to us, is NASA's already taking a look at trying to work on nuclear thermal propulsion. We develop nuclear thermal propulsion, that cuts that trip in half. Why? Because we don't have to worry about launch trajectory. Pretty much, you just launch it, and you have an endless, quote-unquote, fuel supply, and you're able to continue to do the burns as needed without having to use what's called TLI, which is translunar insertion. Clever way of saying, I got to go around a planet a couple of times to get a slingshot to get more speed. Okay? So, hey, thank you all so much for your time. Miss Valerie. That is nothing, any idea, anything that you have. If you have a dream about doing something, the only person that can stop that is you. And that's the only person that can also achieve that dream. So make that a certain within yourself.